Thank you, thank you. Death. There are few things more significant than death. All throughout our lives, we face death. We encounter it on a daily basis. Death is feared. Death is worshipped by some. But one common theme is, death is accepted. Now, what if we change that? What if we did not accept death? That is the basis of my talk today. My talk is based on cryonics. And for those of you who don't know, cryonics is the field that concerns itself with preserving clinically dead persons in the hopes that future technology may be able to revive them. And as you can see, it adopts a more literal approach to the theme of reviving humanity to see where that leads us to. Now I know what you all are thinking. Cryonics sounds like something a guy in a tinfoil hat would say, while also muttering something about how the government controls all our minds. Yes, that was my attempt at a joke. But before we jump to conclusions, why don't we examine the facts? Cryonics is based on a very simple yet observable belief that scientific advancement is progressing at an extremely rapid rate. Take diabetes. At the beginning of the last century alone, having diabetes meant you had a death sentence. The life expectancy of a diabetic was just 4 years. Fast forward to today, and a diabetic can expect to have the same long, fulfilling life as his non-diabetic counterpart. Maybe a more extreme example is in order. Just in the 19th century, just 200 years back, no one knew how to treat an infection. The only solution was to saw off the limb to prevent gangrene from killing the patient. And today, infections that would have been considered fatal to us just 200 years back are passed off as nothing. The basic operating principles of cryonics are extremely similar to that of your fridge at home. Actually, they are the same. At sufficiently low temperatures for cryonics, at -196 degrees Celsius below zero, the temperature of liquid nitrogen, molecules don't have enough energy for chemical reactions to occur, and microorganisms stop growing. So bodies may be preserved indefinitely without any change. Yet this freezing, yet this storage at such a low temperature poses its own set of problems. If a body were to be rethawed back from this low temperature, it would shatter like how glass shatters when hit. Moreover, the main problem that faces cryonics today is the formation of ice crystals during the process of freezing. Ice crystals, as they expand, cause severe damage to body cells. This problem can be overcome, in fact, by the use of anti-freeze solutions, such as glycerol. Yet, again, this causes even more problems, because these solutions are extremely toxic, posing even more problems for the scientists of tomorrow working towards reviving frozen humans. And not to mention, the most important organ, the organ that defines you, the organ that should absolutely be cryogenically preserved, your brain, is an extremely delicate structure. Pumping it full of anti-freeze solutions would cause rupturing and information loss. Loss of information that defines who you are. Whether cryonics works or not, it nevertheless leaves us with a whole host of extremely interesting and important questions. Firstly, do we all have a right to be frozen? Upon first glance, it may seem that we do. It may seem simply an extension of human individual liberties. We have control over our own bodies while we are alive. Why not in death as well? But upon closer inspection, it is far more complicated. Cryonics carries an enormous financial burden which would be placed on your loved one, on your loved ones. The lowest cost cryonics treatment is $28,000, not to mention the emotional and financial and mental anguish that your loved ones would face. And what if we all decided, everyone in this room, decided to be cryogenically frozen? It would take a lot of electricity, a lot of space, and this may simply turn out to be a waste of scarce resources, as cryonics has not been proven till date. Another question that is very important is, should the parents of a dying child look at cryogenic freezing as a viable option? And please be aware that this is not the realm of science fiction. Just back in 2016, a UK court granted the wish of a dying 14-year-old girl, a girl suffering from terminal cancer, to be cryogenically frozen, despite her father's objections. On one hand, if cryonics ever gains mainstream relevance, parents would be tormented and guilt-stricken by the fact that they did not give their child a second chance at a full life, however improbable that chance may be. But yet again, it would come with the enormous financial and emotional stress that accompanies cryonics. Finally, there is the question of whether death is inevitable. The question that cryonics sets out to pose in the first place. This is an extremely interesting question because the answer is, surprisingly, yes and no. This is as there are different types of death. Clinical death is defined as cessation of heartbeat and breathing. Earlier, clinical death was thought to be irreversible. But with the advent of CPR and iron lungs and other technologies, clinical death has been proven to be reversible. What about brain death? Defined as the cessation of function of all parts of the brain. As yet, brain death is irreversible. But we do not know whether in the future it may be reversible as well. Whether cryonics works or not, whether humans will ever achieve immortality, we simply do not know. But if there is one thing which I hope you learn from my talk today, it is this, that life is precious. So don't wait to start living after you've been cryogenically preserved. Start living today. Thank you.